This is Old Soul Ice, the Young Elder, and we back. And although it might seem like we're going to take you back, we're indeed taking you forward. Because as you go to the 6 o'clock point and begin to travel to the 9 o'clock point, you're indeed traveling forward, although it appears that you're traveling backwards. Before I get started, I'd like to send a couple shout-outs. Shout-out to one of my teachers, Ass Rod Crazy, for putting in this work. Shout-out Dr. Ben for putting in this work. Shout-out Dr. Clark. Shout-out the whole Black Power Egyptian community for putting in this work so that we can put this thing together and make sense of this thing. And the name of this tape is Don't Tell Me by No Damn Solomon. Without further ado, let dance. So, the Masonic community on the Western Hemisphere and the European centristics of this thing, they lay claim to Solomon being the first Freemason and the father of Freemasonry. Solomon coming around 900 BC. Solomon supposedly received word from his daddy to do the construction of God's temple, and David got it from his God, right? To build a temple erected to his God. And supposedly, he hired a master builder by the name of Hiram Macbeth, the widow's son, right? To construct this temple. We have no evidence of this temple being built. Now, they give you a well and wall, which was built by Herod, which is part of the second temple that Herod built. So they give you a goddamn wall where they go cry at, and they tell you, based off of this, Solomon was the first Freemason, because they have no more evidence. They don't even have Solomon's body or Hiram Macbeth to prove their accusation. Now we go into the word masonry. The word masonry means stonework, right? That's inconclusive with laying stone, carving stone, setting stone. Now, if masonry is stonework, then what was the Africans doing 5,000 years ago? 2,000 to 3,000 years before Solomon was even born, the Africans were cutting, carving, and laying stone. You say, well, how do you know that? Well, let's take them back, right? Let's take them back to a king named Chase Kimwa, right? In 2756, he built a wall called the Shoe Net in Abydos, Egypt, right? And we're gonna show you pictures of that right now, right? And this goes back over 2,000 years before Solomon. And you tell me that Solomon was the first Freemason? So if we're going off the father of Freemasonry off a wall, hell, we can say Pharaoh Chase Kimwa was the father of Masonry. He was before Solomon, and Chase Kimwa's son was Dozer, who later on hired his master builder, Imhotep, who was the real grandmaster, right, to construct the Stepstone Pyramid. But if we're going off walls here, what would we call Chase Kimwa, right? Because he built a wall that's still there today. A being who lived to be 95 years old, who ruled over 20 years, right? Who is Dozer's father. So if Solomon built a wall, and that's what you're going off calling him the father of Freemasonry, what should we call Chase Kimwa? There are different instruments used in masonry, right? Like the chisel and the mallet or the hammer, right? And we can take you back to the first dynasty, to the pharaoh Narmer, also known as Menes, right? Back to 3013 BC, when this being had the chisel. Take a look at it. He had a chisel and he has the apron on. The brother of the craft have his apron on. Damn near over at least 2,000 years before Solomon, this brother got the chisel and the mallet and the apron and the square in Egypt. And you gonna tell me about some damn Solomon? Get real. A close look at the layout, you'll see that Norma is a little taller than the other fellow, because Norma was a Watusi, right? And these little man was a Twi man, right? We show you the Watusis and the Twi man working alongside each other at the beginning of the Nile, right? Because we came from South Africa at the beginning of the mountain called Kilimanjaro, right? And little do you know how it got that name, because there was a certain type of baboons who lived on that mountain, right? And a certain sound was emitted due to some plates sliding together, creating a sound called the jaw sound, causing these baboons to come down out of the mountain and kill everybody in the village, right? So, Kilimanjaro, Kilimanjaro. See? So we come from the foot of the Nile, where the God happy dwell, right? So these beings, these Watusis, and these Pygmies was already rocking the apron, brothers and sisters. We already had the chisel and hammer. We was already doing stone work, which is the definition of masonry. And you come telling me about some damn hieroglyph bill? Get rid. We already had the square. Shout out Saru the City. They stealing, fam. They stealing, family. Also, if you take a close look at the picture, you'll see the Twa man carrying ritualistic staff. And the one that's in the back, right, of in front of Norma, he's carrying the placenta. Because this represented Norma and the people that he was from. So his placenta, he carried it with him when he traveled, right? And it appears that the being behind Norma is carrying some type of refreshment, right?
Junior stewardess.
Right? And if you see the flower-looking thing, that's really the sun, which later on became the six-pointed star. We're gonna get into that though. We're gonna get right into that. And check out the square right above it, okay? So we point these things out for you. And this is the Pharaoh Norma from the first dynasty, 3013 BC. Brothers and sisters, Africans buried their pharaohs in style. Before Imhotep, they were burying their kings in what they would call master box, right? It's like the bottom layer of a stepstone pyramid, right? And we're showing you pictures of what they look like. So Africans been laying stone for grave site and been cutting and carving stone, because we take you to the real Grand Lodge, right? Which is the temple in Karnak, right? The temple in Karnak is the real Grand Lodge. And if you ain't being raised up in the temple of Karnak, you cannot call yourself a real Grand Master, brothers and sisters, right? And like I told you, Africans are Masonic by birth. Right? Because we come from the real lodge, which is the black woman, right? The black woman womb is the real lodge, right? And you can't be a part of the craft of Amun-Ra unless you are born of the black African woman, right? You can't be a part of that. And for all you Moors out there don't like the word black, hold tight. We got something for you too. So many tribes came into our holy land, and we ain't talking about Jerusalem. We're talking about the mother Africa. They came to our holy land, to the temple of Karnak, and learned and got educated and took that science back to their homeland and went for what they know. And we're about to get ready to point that out to you, okay? So after Kim Chase Y and his wall, his son Dozer, who hired his master builder, Imhotep, the real grandmaster. Check him out. Imhotep, the real grandmaster, who really put in work, who really changed the game to evolute towards this pyramid style. Because as it is above, so it is below, right? Because we came here in pyramid style ship. And when the beings seen this, they wanted to imitate this, because we were from Orion and we drove these UFOs, or what they were called today, but they're really Baba Thabas. Pyramid-shaped ship, thus giving them the increment of the idea to want to create the heaven on earth situation because you gotta understand that when we came here, we were green, and we're going back to Osiris. We were Orion beings who came from Orion in these pyramid-style ships. So they wanted to emulate that and to create a burial site that would resurrect their king and send them back to Orion or to Cyrus. Imhotep was the first one to make an attempt to go towards these pyramid-style burial sites. And what he did is took a master box, and stack six more on top of it, one being smaller than the next, sort of like a wedding cake. So Imhotep gets an A for effort on trying to lean towards the pyramids, and he was the first man to start putting this into play.
As I said before, Imhotep, the multi-genius, long before Michelangelo, long before Thales, long before Pythagoras, this is the African that built this step pyramid right here for his pharaoh, King Zoser, in the third dynastic period, almost 5,000 years ago in the old dynastic kingdom. But yet we are told, our children are told, that Hippocrates was the father of medicine. How could Hippocrates be the father of medicine when Imhotep was a physician in his time? Architect, engineer, who studied the stars, who gave us the circumference of the earth by studying the winter solstice and the summer solstice, long before some Aristophanes, who we are told, gave us the circumference of the earth. This is the story that they don't want us to know, and we'll do everything possible to deny it.
And Imhotep also was a physician and the master of medicine. Imhotep died at 82 years old. He was a master of medicine and herbs. Sound familiar? Dr. Savy died at 82, right? We're gonna get into that, right? So Imhotep was the father of medicine and also the designer of different instruments used in the surgical world today. So don't tell me about no damn hypocrisy, who studied under Egyptian science and plagiarized Imhotep's work. It's plagiarizing today, and it will plagiarize 5,000 years ago. So don't tell me about no damn white boy from Germany or from Greece who came out with nothing when they thought the world was flat when they came in. They were dumb as a box of rocks when they came into Egypt. All they know is kill, steal, and destroy. That's all they knew. Imhotep also designated positions, setting up the format for the Masonic order. You know, the inter-apprentice, the fellow craftsman, and the master mason, all having different positions in the building of his stepstone pyramid as a monument to his pharaoh Dozer, which they completed the building in 2649, and Dozer died 1 year later. If you travel around the world, you can see, if you go to South America or Central America and look at the style, the building of the pyramids, you can see that they took the ideas from African concepts of a pyramid. They mostly have steps on pyramids down there. And Imhotep's pyramid dates back farther, so you can see where they took the concept from. Then we go into a pharaoh named Huni, who makes an attempt to build a pyramid, which they give the credit to Sneferu, but we have reason to believe that it was a pyramid constructed by Huni in the attempt to reach one central point of the pyramid. After Huni, right, we go into Sneferu, who makes an attempt and gets his master builder to make an attempt on the pyramid and almost able to come to a point and almost completes a true pyramid, but not quite. Then Sneferu makes another attempt and he comes up with a true pyramid, which is the Red Pyramid. So Sneferu is responsible for pretty much over 9 million tons of stone. Now, if that don't qualify you as being a grandmaster, then what the hell is a grandmaster?
Here, okay, to Dajar and see the real true pyramid of Sneferu. This is Khufu's father. In fact, it looks just like the Great Pyramid, doesn't it? But it's Sneferu who wanted to move from the step pyramid of Imhotep that you saw and build the first true pyramid. That means the smooth casing of a true equilateral plane pyramid. But actually, this is not the first one. Actually, there's another one with his grandmaster builder, Zezemont, where they have the bent pyramid. It's in back of this one, a mile down the road. But his architects didn't get it right, and it's in a bent format. So he wanted to build another one. Some even say that in the area of Meidum, that pyramid is possibly Sneferu's too.
This brother moved 9 million tons of stone and created the first true pyramid, right? Sneferu, which is the father of Khufu, which begins the layout at Giza Plateau, which you're about to get into that too. So Sneferu coming out the Imhotep, creating the true pyramid, reaching the true pyramid. And in what year did they do it? This pyramid was completed in 2589. Right? Well, Sneferu was later buried, right? Then his son Khufu comes along and begins to lay out at Giza and move 7 million tons of stone, brothers and sisters.
where our story has been persecuted, and persecuted in a way that we look at it from a European perspective. And what I'm trying to say is that the pyramid right here in Giza, the Great Pyramid of Khufu, this pyramid is 7 million tons of masonry. 2,300,000 stones put in exact position. Why do I say that? Because we are told that the pyramids are made out of mud and straw. Now, you are right here at the pyramid. The outer casing of these pyramids are 5 tons each, and the inner casing are 50 tons each. This pyramid of Khufu is built in the fourth dynastic period. There were no people at this particular time called Jews who built the pyramids, and definitely not Machin-Begin. Machin-Begin is an Ashkenazi Jew from Poland, and he stood here right where you are now and said his people built the pyramids. But he's able to tell the world that because of the power that they have inflicted upon other people to force that story on other people. So we come back here to tell the truth.
7 million tons of stone. And it was taller than the Eiffel Tower before they took the capstone off. And these pyramids were covered with limestone. So they had a reflection of the sun reflected off of them, which tell you the type of technology and science that we as Africans were involved in. And you trying to tell me about some damn Solomon? Who comes 2,000 to 2,500 years later? Get the hell out of here. Then Khufu's son and grandson build their pyramids, and these pyramids align with the Orion star constellation. As it is above, so is it below. And they was wondering why the grandson of Khufu pyramid staggers off. It's because the third star in Orion's belt is staggered a little bit off. They said that half of the Egyptians were myths, but we found Osiris' tomb.
Dr. Hawass discovered just that. A subterranean chamber, and it lies at the bottom of a long shaft not far from the Sphinx. This long hidden chamber honors the greatest of Egyptian gods, Osiris. In ancient myth, he's the principal figure of the country's genesis, a benevolent god king who brought civilization to Egypt, but then was brutally murdered by his brother. Osiris was reborn as the Lord of Eternity, ruler of the dead, the chief judge at the trial of all souls. And as we now learn, he is part of the wonders at Giza.
Maury, we talk so much about dispelling myths. How about confirming one? About 2,500 years ago, the Greek historian Herodotus, who I guess you could call the world's first foreign correspondent, visited this site. Local villagers and guides told him that he could find the tomb of a king buried deep beneath the Giza Plateau. Well, about a year ago, Dr. Zahi Hawass, who joins me here at the mouth of the shaft, embarked on what he calls his greatest adventure ever. Zahi, you've been doing this for some 30 years. Why is this so amazing?
Susie, it's amazing because this is the first time that I excavate underneath 100 feet in water before I excavate on sand and dirt. And also at the same time, I discovered that this is what Herodotus talked about. And I found that this is the tomb of Osiris. Let's go and see what we're talking about.
Our first descent is about 20 feet, a chance to get warmed up to the rickety, rusty ladders. Now it gets intimidating. The second leg is a major drop as the shaft narrows before opening to a room once obscured by dirt and sand. Zahi and his men cleared it to find a burial chamber with 6 rooms. So this is the second level, 55 feet down, right?
Yeah.
What did you find here?
You know, I excavated this part. I found 6 rooms cut in the rock, 2 red granite sarcophagus. Off because it's so hot there.
Oh, my. Upon discovery, the third level was submerged. When the water was pumped out, Dr. Hawass had the find of his life. No fear of the unknown?
Yes, but there is great adventure. Adventure in archaeology. خلاص. عفوا بقى ورجع هناك.
So we're 100 feet down now. What is this?
Susie. This is the tomb of Osiris,
the god of the underworld. This once extravagant mausoleum, a moat with four pillars engraved with hieroglyphics constructed thousands of years ago, was intended to be a symbolic shrine for the keeper of the afterlife.
Right? So not no myth no more. They found Osiris' tomb under the Sphinx. So show me Solomon's tomb. Osiris go back down there 10,000 years. And they found this tomb. Why can't you find me a tomb for Solomon? If he was such a master builder, why wouldn't he build a damn tomb for himself? Egyptians build tombs that weigh 7 million tons. You know what I'm saying? Of stone. Now that's masonry there. And you gonna come tell me about some damn Solomon? We can take you over to Meruka's Mastabot and show you the being with the apron on and the Madeline chisel 1,000 years before Solomon. And you gonna tell me about some damn Solomon? And we gonna cut to a tape where one of my teachers,
Ass Ride Crazy,
actually put boots on the ground.
Again, now you can feel the effect of this most powerful mastaba of Meruka. We are right here inside a mastaba that has over 300 rooms. This brother formed his mastaba for his whole family, like a home with rooms and many rooms, and look how large it is. And we're talking about doing the old kingdom. And he was a tajeti, or what is known as a vizier for Teti. Now, what was his job? What did he do? He looked over all the others who were the builders of the mastabas. He also was the overseer of the craft in the area. Now, what relationship can we connect that to what we know today? That is masonry. This is where he was the overseer of, he was the grand master of all the crafts, all the workers in this area. So he was a very serious grand vizier. It would be equivalent to somebody like Imhotep. But he was for Teti. Now, of course, to become such a high status, you had to go to school for 40 years to become the Grand Master. This, he was what you would call a son of light. The son of light was achieved by opening up of his mind, opening up his pineal gland. The position that you will see of all the Grand Masters, such as Meruka, is with his left leg forward. There are, and many of the other kings, you always see the left leg forward. Why is the left leg always forward? The left leg is forward, first of all, because the heart is on the left side, and they must trample down evil. Evil is always present. Our ancestors understood the laws of opposites, so he must walk with his left foot forward to trample down evil so his heart can go forward. See, as you trample it down, then your heart will go forward. So this was the purpose of the left leg forward, to trample down evil for his heart to go forward. Guy, his name is George Washington. He has his left leg forward. Look at the collar and the apron. Where did it, now you have come back, all the way back, and seeing the origin. But we want to see, show you where this came from. This didn't start in no 1717 tea house in England. This was the 360 degrees what we had, not no 33 degrees, a few degrees above freezing. These were the true grand masters. This is the origin. So why would you go back to Jerusalem with Solomon's temple? Why they put this symbol on the dollar bill? They knew where the light of the knowledge came from. The pyramid, here where you are, brothers and sisters, which you saw up on that hill. Why were they using these symbols? Now you understand why we were not allowed to deal with Kemet, was what is called the wasket, the collar, as you see him wearing right here. You see Meruka? You see where the Grand Master's grip of the lion's paw. See the lion's paw on Meruka? You see the paws right there? For those that may be in masonry, when you know, and the third degree, Grand Master's grip of the lion's paw was supposedly when Solomon grabbed Hiram and raised him up. But look at the, now keep in mind that Meruka was the Grand Master's. Look at the Grand Master's grip of the lion's paw. Look at the lion's paw right there. See on his garment right there? Collar. This is where the origin of the Grand Master's grip of the lion's paw came from.
at this place to show you is there and that we ain't playing no games with you, okay? So we just want to lay the groundwork for you. Also, the art form, which is martial arts, really means the god of war, right? Or war god for Greek, right? Africans been had the art form called the Mantu form or the Mantu art form, which Africans practiced thousands of years before it was even a Chinese on the planet. And you come telling me about some damn Bruce Lee?
We, when we're into arts, all the various forms that we find ourselves in, and we still find ourselves in the deification of somebody else's culture or some other people. Like, for instance, martial arts. If you go in a dictionary, you'll find that martial means a Roman god of war. Who would want to identify with a Roman god of war? And especially when you look at the art defense system that all of you will have an equal chance to see in just a few minutes. Long before martial, a Roman god of war, and long before the Asian art defense system, the origin of all of that came right here in Kemet. It was called the Mantu. The Mantu art form was an African defense system. Long before a Roman god of war called martial art. Here you see another art form even using the sticks. And the art form. The one we look at is some kind of a karate chop. And then you see a flip that's taking place right here. So here you see, right, what they call judo. Here you see a flip right here, and also another form of the art with the brothers are trying to defeat the other and bring him down. So here you see an African.
They tried to strip Africans of everything. People that created the icebox, the people that created the flashlight, the people who created the stoplight, the people who created peanut butter and all these other different things. And they try to cut us off and give our credit to anybody other than Africans. They don't want Africans to have nothing as far as creation. At least that's what they tell us on the Western Hemisphere. They try to cut us off from all of our inventions and how great we are. The Mantu art form, which is the original form of martial arts, was practiced thousands of years by Africans. And these same Africans, who were called the same people in Bushman at one point, who migrated to a place you call Asia, these people took that Mantu art form to Asia with them, and then later on passed it down from generation to generation to now they got karate, judo, all these different names for a different culture, but it goes back to the African Mantu art form. So Africans are the first civilizers. We are the foundation of civilization, man. We taught every other people on the planet without a doubt. And don't lie, Illuminati, you know about the temple in Karnak, which you go do your rituals at midnight at a certain point in the year. But you could never be truly part of the crown of Amun Ra because you wasn't born of the black woman, the African woman, the true lodge. We never let you in. You stole 22 tablets, Englishmen, and tried to use these 22 tablets to set up the York rites. But you couldn't even translate them because there were Moors already in that land in England who helped you translate them, but they only gave you 3 degrees. I see your grandmasters crossing their legs. I don't recollect no grandmaster in Egypt crossing his legs. And for all you beings that don't like the word Egypt, cool. We can use Tamaray, Kemet, Akubaland, Nubia, Ethiopia, Sudan, whatever floats your boat, right? But I don't see no grandmaster in Egypt crossing his legs. You see the Pharaoh Ramesses sitting down proper like a real grandmaster. You see Imhotep sitting down proper like a real grandmaster. We didn't cross our leg. That's a lesser form of the information which we gave to you, Caucasoid. And I mean that not in no disrespectful way. It's just the truth, fam. And the truth sometimes will hurt, but the truth will make you free. So you're not no real grandmaster sitting like this, wearing a top hat. You're a real grandmaster if you sit like this. Black power, black power. Shout out my brother Cyril the Sith. But we Moors who already ruled England at the time of this dusty Greek, still in 22 tablets from Egypt, trying to set up that York rite. So we translated a little bit up for them to square them off because they were down, you know, crawling like a dog in the caves. They were just coming out of the caves, right? So we gave him a little bit of the information to square him up. Go on, get him. I'm finna get him. Hold up, Tahuti. Hold up. So the crowd for Amun-Ra goes back at least over 6,000 to 7,000 years. Well, these beings been wearing an apron, been having a chisel and hammer, been putting in stone work. But you wanna cut off the African centricity and say that you came up with it on your own and not give us the credit. But we on to your game now. Then you even put into the brother's mind over here on the Western Hemisphere, who call themselves Prince of the Halls, or the Prince Hall Freemasons, that their brother of the craft of Amun-Ra, who are coming from the African Lodge, is clandestine. When Prince of Hall supposedly got his chapel from England, which we told you, these white boys set up their own shit based off of the translation of the Moors off 22 tablets that they stole, and set up the York Rites.
Old York, as in Yorkshire.
Right? And then the Scottish later on came in stealing 11 tablets, right? Giving you 33, right? The Scottish Rites, right? Which is a bunch of bull and a bunch of baloney, because they are thieves and tomb raiders. That's what they are. So you only was given and translated by the African brothers called the Moors 3 degrees. And with this 3 degrees, you tried to double it up and call it honorary studies. And you stole our double-headed phoenix and turned it into a double-headed eagle and called yourself 32 degrees. Scottish Rites, Freemason. Yeah, right. And let me tell you, double-headed birds go back over 6,000 to 7,000 years old. You wasn't even around then, Scottish man. So you get your chapel from the English man, who is a liar and a thief. Cause let me tell you, Prince Hall's wasn't his real name, Prince Hall Brothers. His name was Big Ben Bay, right? Benjamin Banneker, right? Who helped set up the layout of the White House in Washington, D.C. Brother, who invented the clock, who helped these beings travel over here, right, and find their way from Barbados. Benjamin Bay was born in Barbados. They lie and give you the story. One story is he was born as a free man. One story is he was born as a slave. And they sell you on Prince Hall's because Benjamin Banneker tied the lodge into the Grand Lodge of Karnak, called into African Lodge, and try to lie and say he needed a chapel from England, but Benjamin Banneker ain't need a chapel from England because we had already had our Grand Lodge in Philadelphia, the Moorish Grand Lodge in Philadelphia, which the president, black president, a Moorish president for you Moors, the Moorish president named John Hanson, who was a man who talked the people into signing the Declaration of Independence, who was a black man who signed his signature to the Declaration of Independence. So in order to cover up the history of the black people, of the Moors, the Africans, who are already living on this land that you call America today, in order to cover up the Masonic connections back to Kemet on the temple in Karnak, they say we gotta take this African off, right? Because this was, because he really set the lodge up in connection with the lodge in Karnak, right? So these white boys say we gotta cut this connection off, because if they make that connection, it'll go back way farther than us. Because we already laid the foundation for you and showed you how far Masonry go back. And the Africans are the first people on the planet doing. So they want to cut that African part off and put the Prince Halls on it. So they made up a story about Prince Halls getting inaugurated or getting brought into or sponsored by one of these captains or these military guys in a lodge in Boston, which is a bunch of crap. Prince Halls didn't need no damn chapel from them, because his name wasn't Prince Halls, his name was Benjamin Bay. Benjamin Banneker Bay. You hear it? And if you want to know about that, the Bays, the Moors, go back and check out My Majesties of America Part 1. It'll catch you up on what's going down here, okay? So we had already had a Grand Lodge in Philadelphia, right, set up, which I told you that John Hanson, the first Moorish president, or the black president, and there was 8 presidents
before
George Washington, who was a general and was brought into the president by the man John Hanson, the dark man, the black man, the Moorish man, the African. You know what I'm saying? And some of y'all like the word African, because they say African means Ifriqiya, which means to divide us up, right? And then another group, and like Dr. Ben, he says that Africa comes from the word Afar, from the Afar tribe, right, of Ethiopia and Sudan, right? So we are painting this picture for you to show you what we're trying to do for you is put in your mind on what's going on here, okay? They snatch off the African, off the lodge, and put Prince Hal's lodge, and then proceeds to move the Prince Hal's lodge to cover up the Moore's Grand Lodge in Philadelphia. Now move the black Prince Hal lodge to Philadelphia to cover up the Moore's lodge, and then make the Prince Hal's Grand Lodge based out of Philadelphia when they know that it was already a Moore's Grand Lodge there. And they took the African off and applied to Prince Hal's, implying that Prince of Hall's was a slave to a man named William Hall, right? So they can make it like niggas got their masonry from slaves, thus they deserve to go through the slave rituals, which is why they gave you the slave rituals, family, right? Because you don't know the story, right? Yaku taught them their trickery, and then they were allowed to come into our land, and they turned it upside down. So what we did is to round them up, family. Blindfold them, cable tore them all together, round they go up with them, because they were goat herders. You know, Hyksos, they were goat herders, which is why you use the goat in your Masonic order. You know what I'm saying? We round these beans up, blindfolded them, right? We tied them up, cable towed them together, and marched them across the burning sand back to the cave. And the reason why we blindfolded them is so they wouldn't see where they going, because we knew how to move about using the stars, right? So we marched them through the burning sand on 2 feet with no shoes on, so they can burn and be tortured on their way back. Try to walk on sand in this 120 degree weather, right? So what they had done, this was a part of their torture, what they were doing to our people. And some of them sit on a goat to help ride through the sand because their feet was burning so bad, right? They got on the goat to ride the goat across the sand so that some of them rode the goat, right? And you talk all this ride the goat talk and don't know what the hell you talking about. Understand what a goat is all about. See, a goat is an independent animal who can survive by himself. He don't need a shepherd. A goat can live in the side of a mountains by itself and defend himself from wolves with his horns. Goats eat just about anything. See what I'm saying? So a goat is an independent creature versus a sheep who needs a shepherd to lead and guide him to all the places, to the green pastures, to the water, and to defend him from the wolves. So there's a difference between a sheep and a goat, my brothers and sisters. So we marched them across the burning sands with their cable tow around their neck and their blindfold on. Before we started the march, we stripped them of all their medals and all of their everything that they had, that had nothing. When we stripped them and marched them across the sand back to the cave, because they came into our holy land and turned it upside down, okay? And when they took the cable toes off their neck, they had red necks from the sun and the heat on the cable toe burning their neck. Thus, they inherited the name Rednecks. Truth is truth, man. So now they're selling, they sold you. They took your African off your lodge to cut you off from their connection. They changed the Prince Hall, told you his name was Prince Hall, to cut you off from the Bay, the Moorish connection, to let you know that you was already here. Moved the Prince Hall's Grand Lodge to Philadelphia and erased the original Grand Lodge of the Dark Moors that was here. And then sold you some slave ritual and got you thinking that you were walking around talking about you a Mason, right? And where's your stonework, right? Got you walking around talking about you a Mason, and you reach out, and not all of you, and I'm not dissing all the Prince Hall brothers. Shout out to some of my Prince Hall Masons who putting in some work, because they putting in work in another way, in the community, by giving back to the community, by buying bikes, by having cookouts for the homeless, helping rebuilding old people's homes, and building playgrounds and recreational centers for kids. So all of you good Masons out there who are part of the Prince Hall brother lodges that are doing these things, black power, brother. You know what I'm saying? But we're going to straighten you out, though. We're going to put you on your information. As Africans, been had this information. Don't let them play you, fam. Don't fool yourself. So nowadays, when they bring you in the lodge, they table toe you, right? Take your shoes. Some of them, the nice ones, they give you slippers. Some of the rich lodges, and the Polars, they take all your shit. They take all your medals, same thing we did to them. And they give you these rituals and got you going through them thinking you're going through the original rituals when they never got the original rituals of the craft of Amun-Ra. You gotta go to the Temple of Karnak to get that. And in order to go to the Temple of Karnak, you gotta come out of a real lodge, a real constituted lodge of God, which is the Black Woman's Womb. So stop playing games with us and don't tell me about no damn Solomon. Cause you only got 3 degrees. And that other shit that you made up, 32 and 33, is all baloney. And you know it's baloney. And the truth hurts, right? So your 32 degrees, could we understand that water freezes at 32 degrees, right? So those who are 32 degrees are froze. They can't speak nothing. Can't nobody talk like I'm talking right now. They can't talk like we talk when they are made the oath, right? And you can go check what you want to check out on me. I ain't never made the oath, fool. And ain't nobody sponsored me. Yo, this is Total Recall. You know all about it now, don't you? Man, they still trying to figure out how we build the pyramids today. And they had a nerd to tell you aliens build it. Man, we are the aliens that they talking about. Talking about they build it from the top down. How? Like Dr. Ben said, did they hang it on the cloud passing by? I mean, use your common sense here. We just showed to you how these brothers developed this over a period of time of their masonry. Going back thousands of years, over 5,000 years ago. So the plot was to cut you off, which is why they cut the African off and put the Prince Hall's slave name up there to hold you true. Because, which is why they're the only one that go around calling themselves free and accepted. If you gotta admit to being free, then you admit to once being not free. You once admit to being a slave. And like I say, Moors are not slaves, we are not Slavics, right? Slavics are Russian, okay? So all you brothers, and how secret are you walking around with all your rings on, right? With the signs all over your car and your paraphernalia all over the place. How secret are you marching in parade, right? And then try to call yourself a grandmaster because you wear a top hat, right? And you used all the signs you got, you stole half of them from Egypt. And you don't even got all of them right. Right? Like Saru the City say, they stealing, fam. They stealing. Shout out Saru the City. They stealing. And yeah, I know all your shit. Thing I don't wanna do, come try me. I can be tried by the square. I can be tried by the chisel or the mallet. Yeah, yeah, yeah. We got all your rabbits down to the teeth. Straight from the mouth or to who teeth. And yeah, the T's are older than the Rays. And you niggas are the Does who nobody seemed to know. And you wanna call yourself the Illuminated Ones? Well, like Artoon Ray say, illuminate these nuts. So, all you brothers out there, you Black Mason brothers, come on over to Oso Ice. So we can teach you your real history, brother. Your real science, brother. Come on over to Oso Ice so we can teach you the real, how to be real true Mason. Cause it seems like to me, y'all more focused on material things than the spiritual side of things. Yeah, yeah, I know how to get in your lodge. Yeah, Matthews 7 and 7. Knock and the door shall be open. Yeah, and I know how many times to knock. Thing I don't wanna do.
And you thought you almost had, didn't you? When you asked me to rearrange, when you rearranged your furniture and thought that I couldn't put it back in its rightful place. Well, I sure did show you did. Putting everything back in its rightful location. And I told you, you can try me all you want, but you can never deny me.
So I've been in and seen how you operate, right? And we know that you operate in a wrong format. A format that was given to you by slaves, so they only can give you a slave ritual. So come on home, family, and stop going through the back door of this white dude shit that he made up off top of his head, pretty much. Because 33 degrees is not square. 90 degrees is square, brother. And yeah, we know why you're mad, because you saw the God men holding this staff, holding this 15 piece, black as night. Shooting the square with his left arm with the acute anger on it. You know what I'm saying? So that, they go your square right there. That's what they mad about. Penis envy. Cause we packing. Brothers packing. You know what I'm saying? The God men, the true God of fertility. You know what I'm saying? And these things men know. And yeah, we know all about what your two balls and a cane is always about. Fertility. And we are not descendants of Cain. I am Abel, are you? A cane is what a disabled person would use to move around. And yo, Nubians, we get around. Don't you see? You can't go one place on the planet mistakenly calling Earth and not see a Nubian there. And yeah, I know, I got you saying, yeah, who is this kid? Nigga, this is old So-Ice, the young elder, student of Atum Re. And hey, we know all about your three candlesticks, your three great lights, right? The worship of Master, the Sun, and the Moon. Well, see, in that you're incorrect there, see, because you don't have the real teaching, see? The moon has no light of its own. Therefore, the moon is not a great light. The moon is a lesser light, fool. And yeah, your three great lights is a representation of Egyptian teachings, of ancient Kemet teachings. Atum, and Amun. These all being raised in positions of the sun. So stop playing games with us. And don't let them play games with you, family. Because the story goes, there was a builder who was killed before he got through constructing the great temple. They said, how did he kill him? Well, they killed him by knocking him in the top of his head. And what happens to a man when he get knocked on top of the head? He gets amnesia. He forget. So we have forgotten this information. But now we're here at the Oso Ice. It's here to bring it back to you. This builder was built in a saddle grave in the north. What a time did they go looking for him at 6 o'clock in the morning. This builder is you, black man, who were put in a tomb, and they placed guards on a tomb called Shriners to keep you from getting out. We here at Oso Ice are here now to roll back that stone, brother. Come on out. We're grabbing you with the lion's paw with the strong grip and raising you up in the craft of Amun-Ra. Rise and take your rightful place, brother and sister. And don't tell me about no damn Solomon. The temple layout of Solomon's temple is a copy of the same temple as Ramesses and half the other temples in Egypt. So the god that they got it from must have been the Egyptian god. There are temples dating back thousands of years before Solomon's temple with the same layout. So what god did Solomon get the information from? Must have been the Egyptian god. Yeah. We know the original Knights of Templar were black Moors. Stop playing with us. And when you see an African Mason, a being who of the original craft of Amun-Ra, don't open your mouth to call them a clandestine. Because Albert Pike, the being who set up your Scottish Rites or your Western Hemisphere's Masonic Order, who set up the 33 degrees system, who's also the founder of the Ku Klux Klan family, in his writing, when asked about the chapel for black men or African men, said that he's not entitled on speaking on the matter. But the day niggas are in line into Masonry, he getting out of Masonry. This is the nigga who supposedly is the leader who set up Freemasonry on this side of the globe. And this is what he has to say about Prince of Hall Black Mason. Another dude who goes by Ronald Bright, who has a book called A Glance at Freemasonry, said that all Negro Masonry is clandestine. And he's a 33rd degree Freemason, man. So you see, black Masonry is not recognized by European Masonry because they know the truth. They know that you don't even got your original teachings. You got teachings that they gave you, which is why they don't even recognize you. They stealing, family. They stole the distress call from the sign of Mad. They stealing, family. So don't tell me about no damn Solomon. This is Young Elder, signing out.